So it's a great pleasure to have Professor Eugenio Bianchi from Eberly College of Science, Pennsylvania State University. He's working at the Department of Physics. I met him last December. We talked a lot, and I'm very happy to have that he agreed to give a talk for this forum, QASTM. This is the 22nd talk in the series, and I'm thankful to him for giving his time for this forum. And I'm not going to say more thing about that, more thing about him, but I just small thing. He did his PhD from SNS PISA in 2010. And he was a postdoc also at Perimeter Institute. And he got a lot of fellowships, prizes. You guys can check his profile, but I will not go into that. Rather than I will prefer to talk about the subject he is going to speak. He will talk about typicality of small spins in primordial black holes, from the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy to gravitational wave observation. So hopefully we will learn from a very theoretical perspective to the observational perspective. So so thank you, Eugenio, for your talk. And we are waiting for your talk. So like you can start speaking from now.
Thank you, Sayantana. Thank you for the invitation. I'm really happy to contribute and participate to this seminar series. I've participated to some and watched most of the seminars in this series, and they're always enjoyable and very informative. Today, I would like to tell you about some work I've been doing with my colleagues in gravity, quantum gravity, and gravitational wave observations, in particular with Anuradha Gupta, who is now assistant professor at Ole Miss, Hal Haggard from Bard College, and Satya Satya Prakash, who is at Penn State. And the topic is, as you mentioned, Bekenstein-Hawking entropy and possible observational effects. So let me set the stage. When we speak about classical black hole physics today, we rely on the fact that we have an abundance of observations. This is recent and it is impressive. If we look just at the month of April last year, when the third observing run of LIGO Virgo started, you can see that there are events essentially every week. And this abundance of observation has pushed general relativity out of its initial very mathematical setting and has provided more than observation and tests, also an instrument for looking at the broader universe. But before that, before having an abundance of observations, black holes were theoretical laboratories. Theoretical laboratories for studying and exploring the physics of dynamical spacetimes, like horizons, singularities, asymptotic structures. And one might argue that today we are in a similar situation where, despite the fact that we don't have any access to observations of quantum aspects of black hole physics, still, black holes play a central role as theoretical laboratories for studying the quantum nature of space-time and quantum gravity, as, for instance, in my group we do for loop quantum gravity, or in a broader community, studying properties of quantum information and entanglement. And many of these investigations have started by thinking about black holes, their entropy, the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy and information paradox. They have started within studying black holes, but then they have had a way broader impact in theoretical physics and even in condensed, in particular in condensed matter. And among other things, properties of pure states, thermal properties of pure states.
So, Eugenio, please,
yes.
Can you elaborate how this is related to condensed matter physics, and like how like people can connect those things with this black hole site?
Yeah, the comment is there is an observation, black hole behave as thermal objects. Still, they are simple objects and as theoretical laboratories, they are pure systems. And so it's correct to ask the question, how is it possible that a system in a pure state behaves as having thermal properties? And I think it's really the realization within black hole physics that this can happen that has then later be generalized and now is part of a paradigm, the against state thermalization hypothesis, where even if you have a system that is isolated in a pure state, when you look at subsystems, these subsystems can have thermal properties that are related to the energy of the full system. So this was the comment.
Yeah,
and clearly these are things that one can test in condensed matter systems, and one can prepare in a lab, and the huge development in that direction is driven not only by theory, but also by numerical experiments, and by the fact that some of these systems can be prepared in a lab, and one can actually observe how these thermal properties arise from a time. So all this is good, black hole as theoretical laboratories, but what I would like to do in this seminar is to make some remarks and argue that there are, in principle, observable effects of quantum aspects of black hole physics that we may have access to already now, today. And these are observable effects in the same sense as when one looks at statistical properties of quantum systems that are easier to access than really looking at the microscopic properties like the quantum structure of space-time. So let me elaborate on this point. The key question is, are black holes simple or complex? Within general relativity, they are vacuum solutions, and at equilibrium, they are just two parameters, the mass and the spin. So simple. On the other hand, they have huge entropy, the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. And this is a quantum phenomenon. There's an h-bar here at the denominator, exactly as there's an h-bar at the denominator in the entropy of the electromagnetic field at finite temperature. And the question is, if they have this huge entropy, then it means that there's a homogeneous large number of microstates, so they are complex. Now, this is not a small difference because we know that systems that have a large number of microstates behave as statistical systems, and there are observations of statistical properties that one can make.
I just want to ask one thing.
Go ahead.
That spin J you talked about, this is not some quantum number or something. This is some classical.
Yes, thanks for clarifying this at this point because it's going to be crucial. So yeah, I'm really speaking about angular momentum. So if this was a compact object, a star, a neutron star, it would be the angular momentum of the star. And if it's a collapsed object like a black hole, you can still speak about the angular momentum of the object. So yes, it's classical.
Okay.
Good. So here's the key observation. The observation is that if you fix the mass of the black hole, and you consider a rotating black hole with angular momentum J, now it's useful to introduce a dimensionless parameter A. This parameter, as you know, black hole can have at most an extremal spin, Gm squared over C. So this parameter goes between 0 and 1. So there's smallest possible spin is 0, smallest possible angular momentum, and an extreme and largest possible angular momentum. And when you look at a black hole at fixed mass as a function of spin, the observation is that the entropy is smallest at the smallest spin, at zero. And you see it plotted here. The function is rather simple. The Bekenstein of the entropy formula depends on the mass, mass square over mass Planck square, and depends on the dimensional spin in a simple way. And in particular, it's maximum at zero spin, Schwarzschild, and minimum at larger spin when it's extrema. Okay? So the question is, are there observational consequences of this fact, the fact that the entropy is largest at small spin? After all, we know from other systems that there are observational effects that follow from entropy arguments. One standard example is a polymer chain. Yeah, if you take, for instance, a few paper clips, let's say 100, and you stick them, you tie them one to the other, you have a maximum length, and you can also crumple them all together. Now, suppose that you put them on a table, and you start making the table vibrate, and look at what's the typical configuration. Well, of all configurations, the typical configuration, the most likely configuration, is the one of highest entropy. And there it's easy to compute the entropy by just counting microstates. In particular, there are few, or if you want one, when it's completely stretched, but many when it's within a typical radius. And this entropic argument gives you immediately the scale of a polymer chain in equilibrium, and this is observed. So the question is if there's something similar for black holes. And in the case of black holes, I can essentially repeat that argument, that then I'm gonna make more precise, and look for a distribution, not of the length of the polymer chain, but the spin of the black hole, the typical value of the spin or the angular momentum of the black hole. So let me set up the argument. The number of microstates at fixed mass and spin is the exponential of the entropy that I showed before. It's larger when it's smaller. Now, in the microcanonical ensemble, that is the ensemble for isolated systems where only the energy is fixed, in this case, the mass of the black hole, the probability of finding a certain spin is given by the ratio between having that spin and any possible spin with this integration that takes into account the fact that spin is a vector, so there's an e squared dA, or some derivative. Okay? So this probability distribution, I can plot. You see there's a dimensionful scale, the Planck scale. So when I speak about the probability of having a certain spin at fixed mass, I have to declare the mass. If the mass is small, for instance, two Planck masses, yes.
What this probability actually physically corresponds to?
Yeah, so, the analogy with the polymer chain is again helpful. Suppose that you had a black hole that was extracted from an ensemble where only the mass has been fixed. There's nothing else fixed.
Okay.
Okay. And when you extract this black hole from this ensemble, you know already the mass because it was fixed, but you don't know yet what's the angular momentum, and you ask what's the probability of finding some angular momentum. Now, in a moment, I'm gonna go into the direction of physical mechanisms and when we expect this to happen. But at this point, it's really a mathematical statement of if you have an ensemble and you extract from this ensemble one sample, one black hole, what's the probability of finding a certain spin? So in the case of the polymer chain, it would be, think really concretely in terms of these paper clips. I prefer them. I can always prefer them completely stretched. And if I say it's completely stretched, I know that the probability is one that is completely stretched. But if I prefer an ensemble of these chains, where every configuration can be explored, then most of the configurations have a typical extension, and the typical extension is given by a probability formula like this one.
Yeah, okay. So you are saying that there is an underlying connection with the polymer chain with this black hole thing, with spin.
So at this point, I'm using it as an analogy. There is a connection within loop quantum gravity, but I'm not going to rely on that connection. I'm really using the polymer chain as a familiar system that I can use for illustrating the mechanism.
Okay.
So if the mass is Planckian, if it's a small black hole of 10 to the minus 5 grams, then the probability distribution is quite broad. Essentially, you can have even large spins, like 1 hour. However, as you raise the mass of the black hole, the probability distribution becomes more and more centered close to zero. In particular, suppose that you take a solar mass black hole, 10 to the 30 kilograms, then you would have that the average spin is about 10 to the minus 38. So practically zero.
Yeah.
As average. Now, for reference, before I was saying there's a distinction, there's a huge difference between a black hole being a simple object and being a complex object. Yeah, I'm really relying on and looking at the consequences of the fact that theoretically we are convinced that black holes are complex systems that have a statistical mechanics and an entropy given by the Bekenstein of entropy, and the consequence is this probability distribution. But suppose that you didn't know, and you were relying only on general relativity, that tells you that they are simple objects with given mass and spin. And so then you can ask again, what's the probability of having a certain spin? In the absence of other information, besides knowing the mass, you will take the uniform probability distribution. So as in general relativity, spin is in between this range, if you want 0, 1, I can take a uniform probability distribution in 0, 1, and use that as my prior or my statement of what I expect given only the mass. On the other end, once one realizes that spin is a vector, then as a vector on a sphere, it's more likely to have a larger spin than a smaller spin because there's more volume at larger radius. And so you will get this kind of distribution where it's unlikely to have small spin and it's way more likely to have larger spin, and the average spin is around here. So as you can see, the prediction from the statement black holes are simple and the statement black holes are complex are completely different. In one case, the prediction is that the spin is rather large, the typical spin in this ensemble, and in the other that it's essentially zero. So this is the statement that I want to explore and argue that it can be tested with observations.
So for these individual plots, what the peak value corresponds to?
Yes, so the peak is is approximately the average spin.
Okay.
So it's somewhat likely to have a bit less spin, somewhat likely to have a bit more spin, and the average is more or less in the middle.
So that means this is actually predicting the mass of the black hole, because somehow the average.
We are already fixing the mass.
Oh, you are fixing the mass. Okay.
We are fixing the, yeah. So this is important. I'm not giving a distribution for the mass. I'm fixing the mass and asking what's the probability for finding a certain spin.
Okay.
Hi, Eugenio. Can I ask a question?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. So physically, what is exactly happening in the microcanonical ensemble, which is forcing the system to really have small spin?
Can you elaborate?
In the sense, we see that the probability for small spins are quite high. What exactly is forcing it to have small spins?
Oh, I see. Now I understand the question. Okay, so two brief answers. One is the one that I described qualitatively here. That is the Bekenstein-Hawking formula tells you that the entropy is larger at small spin, from which you can infer that it's more likely to have small spin. Why is that? Well, because you could count microstates that go with the number, you can count the microstate and the number goes as the exponential of the entropy. And as here it's larger than down here, you would expect that small spin is more likely. And the direct computation using exactly this formula gives you these plots. Now, as you can see, I'm using something you can say it's thermodynamics, knowing the entropy, and the assumption that this thermodynamics is arriving from microstates and a statistical mechanics of those microstates. So to make this more precise, I have to go into a more specific description of the microstates and the theory of quantum gravity behind the entropy. But I think it's important before doing that to appreciate that the argument is really elementary and doesn't rely on any specific construction or specific theory of quantum gravity, as long as we believe in statistical mechanics and the fact that it is robust. Did it address your question?
So basically, second law of thermodynamics. Which is
second law brings in some dynamics and some evolution in time that I can comment on later. But at this point, I would say even more than second law, it's a statement of equilibrium.
Yeah.
So once you reach equilibrium, then this is what one can expect. And then there's a more complicated question of what's the mechanism to reach equilibrium.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
What exactly happens when the system is not in equilibrium? Can you predict something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if the system is away from equilibrium, there are many ways it can be away from equilibrium and one has to give more input. And that becomes a difficult question now where one really has to consider a concrete system and mechanism of formation. So the one that I'm illustrating is the simplest and cleanest, and as I go on in the seminar, I'm going to introduce some other ingredients that might force me to consider exactly these cases that you're mentioning. That is, what if it's not exactly a technique?
Okay.
In any case, while out of equilibrium questions are important, we also know that thermodynamics is robust and the generic behavior, if there's nothing that blocks the system from reaching equilibrium, is the prediction from equilibrium. And even being close to equilibrium often is good enough. Okay, so some quantum gravity now. So let me try to make more precise the statement that I made before. I don't need to commit to a specific theory of quantum gravity because the argument can be made semi-classically. So I'm gonna discuss the microcanonical ensemble in the form that is discussed also in these papers. By considering first quantum gravity with asymptotically flat boundary conditions. In asymptotic flatness, you have the asymptotic algebra that allows you to identify, among other things, the mass and the angular momentum. Okay? And you can write microstates as an orthonormal basis of your Hilbert space at fixed mass and angular momentum. Now, what's the microcanonical ensemble? Well, it's the ensemble where only the mass is fixed. And compared to this plot that I was describing before, where I'm taking the uniform distribution either on the interval 0, 1 or the uniform distribution in the sphere or radius 1 for a black hole that has only one or few degrees of freedom as a three-dimensional rotating object. What I'm doing in this analysis where I have these peaks is to consider a black hole that is extracted from an ensemble where the uniform distribution is actually classically in phase space and quantum mechanically in the sector of the Hilbert space at fixed mass. So what I need is to define the sector of the Hilbert space at fixed mass, and then take a uniform distribution in this sector. And uniform distribution in quantum mechanics is the maximally mixed density matrix. If I was to do it classically in general relativity, I could ask the same question, but I would encounter the same catastrophe that one finds already in electromagnetism, where if you say take the phase space of the electromagnetic field in a box, the section or the shell, the energy shell in phase space of fixed energy, what is the volume, the phase space volume of this shell? Well, it's infinite. And why it's infinite? Well, that's the ultraviolet catastrophe. I can have infinitely many ways of producing that energy. What quantum mechanics does is to introduce a dimensionful constant, h bar, that relates the wavelength for the electromagnetic field and the energy. And once I have that, the number of states at fixed energy in a finite volume is finite, and I can do statistical mechanics and the microcanonical ensemble. And similarly, I have to be careful. I cannot start with classical general relativity. I would get just an infinite entropy. I have to start at least with semi-classical quantum gravity. And the way I'm describing here uses notions from the full theory, the maximally mixed density matrix at fixed mass, which clearly, as one can infer by looking at this, having it written in terms of angular momentum, can be written as a sum of, or as a mixture of a maximally mixed at fixed mass and angular momentum with a probability that one can compute. It's just given by the ratio of the dimensions, the dimension of fixed mass and spin, and the total dimension that is the dimension of the sector at fixed mass only, which I can write this way. Okay. And so now this is the ratio that I need to compute. And this ratio can be computed semi-classically. How do you compute it semi-classically? Well, So you see, I need this quantity. I need, so let's say that I want to compute dimension of the Hilbert space at fixed mass. How do I do it? Well, the standard trick is to do a Laplace transform. In Laplace transform, I would compute a partition function z of beta, and then I transform back. Where the partition function at fixed beta, or fixed inverse temperature, is the one given by Euclidean quantum gravity. Should probably write it as S beta G mu. Now, this has an H bar. If I focus only on black holes that have mass much larger than the Planck mass, then I can compute this quantity semi-classically in a saddle point approximation, and then take the Laplace transform back. And that gives me a dimension that is e to the Petersen of the entropy times a factor that doesn't really change the conclusion and shows that the result is robust, because what all these other factors do is just to correct the result by logarithmic terms.
But why this strange factor came 212/45?
So here I'm doing a pure gravity. So pure gravity semi-classical. This is the contribution from gravitons.
Okay.
And this you can understand it as the fact that we are in 3D with spin. So there are the degrees of freedom of the angular momentum.
Okay.
And if you add, let's say, the standard model coupled to gravity, you would have all the corrections in here that come from bosons and from fermions.
Yeah.
And that shows again why this formula for the entropy is robust, because all those corrections would appear only if I exponentiate this, would appear here in a logarithm.
But this is just a like Euclidean path integral computation.
Yeah, so this is the Euclidean path integral computation that then you have to transform at fixed mass, or fixed mass and spin by. And so then you plug it into this formula for the probabilities in quantum mechanics, and you get back the expression that I already wrote in the beginning without having to go through full theory of quantum gravity. This is exactly the same. I have two slides back, or one slide back here, where I said, we know how statistical mechanics works. If you have an entropy and you say that that entropy comes from microstates, then you can just count the number of microstates, and the entropy is the ratio between the number at fixed spin and the total number. Okay. There's another comment that is probably important. It is I don't need really that. I don't literally need microstates. The black hole might be in a pure state, and all I need is that the subsystem that is the exterior of the black hole behaves as if it was it was a random state in an ensemble, and this generally happens.
Just one confusion, just want to ask that this subsystem is not actually interacting with the environment. It is in kind of adiabatic that you are considering. Is it an adiabatic system?
Yeah, so I'm considering the macrocanonical ensemble that is the energy is perfectly fixed.
Yeah.
But the energy is something you measure at infinity.
But
Okay.
But like,
and I'm only assuming that the energy speaks, but I'm not saying that you cannot interact with the system. You can interact with the system and change its properties, its microscopic properties. You just cannot change the energy.
Okay. But is why I'm asking that in quantum mechanics, there is a possibility of considering something called open quantum systems, where people used to, where the system exchanges the energy with the environment. So that possibility can be considered in this aspect.
Yeah, good, excellent. So you have a couple of comments. The answer is yes, it can be considered. So if you don't fix the energy, you would still fix some other property. For instance, you would fix the average energy, or equivalently, you would fix the temperature of the system. Now, for self-gravitating systems, it happens that if you fix the temperature, the system is unstable. What I mean is that a small exchange of energy can be amplified. The thing is best seen by fixing the energy and looking at the heat capacity. What you find is that the heat capacity is negative. This happens in all gravitating systems, self-gravitating systems, and black holes are an example of that.
Okay.
Now, having said this, one also has to take into account what's the time scale of this instability. If I do it for a black hole at fixed temperature, in principle, I can compute this quantity. In fact, this is what everybody does when one does semi-classical gravity or Euclidean quantum gravity at fixed temperature. The fact is that this quantity is not well-defined. You first make it well-defined by putting an infrared cutoff, and then the result depends on that cutoff. The interesting thing is that when you do the calculation in the microcanonical ensemble where the energy is fixed, you're exactly avoiding those problems, and that infrared cutoff actually disappears from the result.
Okay.
So the other comment is that there's a time scale that comes with this instability that is essentially the time scale of black hole evaporation. So for the applications that I'm going to discuss in a moment, that time scale is completely negligible because it's way longer than the scales I'm going to consider. For a solar mass black hole, is way longer than the age of the universe itself. And so even if mathematically the system is unstable, physically it's completely okay to consider this a sample. And many of the statements that I'm going to make, even if I always emphasize microcanonical and fixed energy, is because it's mathematically clean and avoids these difficulties, but physically the distinction between the two for shorter times is negligible, and it only amounts to a distinction at the level of these logarithmic corrections.
Okay. Just one more thing to ask, that since you said that there is an instability and that will persist for a time scale, so this instability, is that connected with the non-unitarity and quantum dissipation for this kind of system?
Oh, I see. Yeah. In part, one could argue that in the sense that if you fix the energy, you have that the system is closed and the black hole is not actually evaporating because you are feeding it. What I mean is that the information loss problem arises when the black hole evaporates for long enough. Okay, the old problem is if it evaporates completely. The modern version of the problem, if it evaporates for long enough until a pitch time. But then one can ask, what happens if I don't let the black hole shrink? because I have it in a box that is small enough that it's that the radiation is not allowed to fly away. And so it's not an open system, it's a closed system. I would say many of the questions remain, are still there, but they are not apparent as in the case where you use the instability to show that there's a problem.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah. Okay. So, as you see, all I'm doing is saying if the system is in equilibrium at fixed energy and it's allowed to explore completely the shell of given energy, all of the microstates, all of the possible configurations at that energy. So this is the density matrix of the system. Then the conclusion is small spins. Now, the question to address is, can the system explore this large phase space or all of this Hilbert space at fixed mass and spin? What are the mechanisms that allow it to explore it? Because after all, even in the case of the polymer chain, one could say you make this chain of paper clips. If you put it on the table and you don't do anything, whatever you put, that is what you get. So you need to allow the system to explore all possible configurations. And once it explores all possible configurations, then you just count which ones are more likely and which ones are less likely. But in order to be able to do this simple calculation where you just count, you have to make sure that the system is able to explore all possible configurations. So for the paper clips in the table, the standard physics demonstration is that you start tapping on the table or you have something that makes the table vibrate. And then the paper clips are going to move around and explore the possible configurations till reach a typical length that goes with the square root of the number of paper clips. And the question is there a mechanism for black holes to explore this ensemble? So this is the topic. And so the first observation is that clearly stellar collapse doesn't allow for exploring all configurations of fixed mass. And the reason is that it's a collapse. You have a star, it has some angular momentum, or you have two stars that have also an orbital angular momentum, and then there's a merging event, or there's a collapse of the single star. And in that process, there's a part of matter that is expelled, a part that collapses, and the part that is expelled can carry out some angular momentum, and the part that collapses keeps the angular momentum, and there are no efficient exchanges that allow you to explore that shell in this space. And in particular, the standard paradigm is that if you have a star that is rotating and it collapses, what you should expect is large spins. And this is essentially what has been seen for years in all black holes observed in the galaxy via X-ray, that all have large spins. So one doesn't expect a stellar collapse to lead to an equilibrium configuration in the microcanonical ensemble. So the question remains, when is a population of black holes well described by the microcanonical ensemble? So before I was saying you need the system be able to explore configurations. And in statistical mechanics, the standard argument is that if you have a system that is perfectly free, it cannot really explore configurations. You always need a small, even though negligible for most effects, but still an interaction that allows, for instance, photons in a box to equilibrate, for instance, a piece of coal that absorbs a photon of high frequency and re-emits many photons of smaller frequency so that it equilibrates or explores completely the ensemble. And if it was the case that the energy separation of microstates for a black hole were high energy separations, Planckian separations, then one would need quantum gravity effects. And so one would expect that this can be achieved only for Planck mass black holes, for very small black holes. But the observation is that it is not the case. The relevant interactions for microcanonical equilibrium are in fact infrared, not ultraviolet. And you can see it by looking at the energy separation of energy levels of a black hole. Once you know the entropy, you can estimate the density of states or the typical separation between energy levels. And it has an e to the minus s that tells you that the separation is exponentially small in a square. So what you need for reaching microcanonical equilibrium is not high energy effects, but really long wavelength infrared. So what is a physical situation where one can expect that microcanonical equilibration is relevant? Well, I'd like to argue that the early universe is one place where this can happen. And this is what I want to describe in some more detail. So the question is, black holes produced not by stellar collapse, but primordial black holes. The ones that might have formed in the early universe. Is there a mechanism for them to be automatically microcanonical equilibrium? So let me describe briefly how what is the standard paradigm for primordial black holes as described first by Hawking and Kapp. So consider a homogeneous mass distribution in the early universe. So this homogeneous mass distribution is homogeneous of the cosmological scales. So let's take this distribution. And then this distribution has thermal as a given temperature, but is also expanding. So there's a typical Abel radius. Now, if there's a perturbation, a density perturbation that reaches the threshold for critical collapse, then matter within this Abel radius is trapped. Trapped means that while the density is going down because the universe is expanding, there's a region here inside that remains trapped behind and forms a black hole of essentially the same scale as that Abel radius. So it's not really a collapse phenomenon, it's more a being left behind in a universe that is expanding, being trapped. So the typical scale of this black hole is the Abel scale at that time. And there are two questions now. The first is, how big has to be this density perturbation and what allows this black hole to form? And the second is what is the configuration and how we can explore the microcanonical ensemble? Well, one immediate remark is that if you have something that is already in equilibrium, and it's trapped behind, is already microcanonically distributed. So yeah, you don't really need a mechanism of equilibration starting from away from equilibrium. You have something that is already in equilibrium and remains trapped behind, and it remains trapped behind once it reaches a specific threshold. Now, when does this happen? Well, one specific example that I'm going to consider in more detail is the QCD transition, when the pressure drops And this results in an enhanced black hole production. Okay, so what is this transition? Well, there's a phase in the universe where the density was initially large during the radiation phase. And then as the universe keeps expanding, the density goes down and down and down. Till at some point, the density is comparable to the density of about a pion per pion wavelength cube. Okay? So if a black hole forms during this phase, one can ask what's the mass of the black hole formed during this phase. And the argument for the enhanced production of black holes during this phase is that you have this relativistic distribution where there's a pressure that is the one of the relativistic equation of state. And then as the density goes down and the universe cools down, you reach this phase where you start going through a transition where pions are going to start being produced. And during this transition, as you can see here, it's not a phase transition with a coincidence of phases or a divergence specific heat, but there is a softening of the equation of state. In particular, the speed of sound and pressure go down and then come back again because once you produce these pions, temperature is low enough that they become non-relativistic, but photons start dominate.
So there's the sound speed goes down. So since you were talking about phase transition, so is this following some scaling law?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's not technically a phase transition, even if it was initially thought it could be. It's really a crossover transition. And this is something that people have realized really by looking at numerical simulations of lattice QCD. Okay.
And what is the typical scale of this transition? Means energy scale or something like that?
Yeah. So let me comment on that. Very good. So as I was saying, this is the typical scale is the QCD scale, or if you want the scale of pions. So between 100 and 200 MeV, say 200 MeV. So now let's look at if you form a black hole during this phase, how big the black hole would be. Yeah, so as I was saying before, the black hole forms if there's a density perturbation that is coherent enough over a scale that is the Hubble radius at the time. So the Hubble radius was smaller in the earlier universe, and then it becomes larger and larger, the radius. So if this was to happen at the Planck scale, or the Planck time when the universe was at the Planckian curvature, then if a black hole was to be produced, would be Planck mass, extremely small. In fact, in that phase, it would be even difficult to distinguish black holes from other quantum geometries. So probably not even a relevant notion. If it happened during the inflationary phase, well, it would be maybe 10 to the 5 times larger, maybe a gram, but they would also be diluted very quickly because of inflation. Now, if it happens later during the radiation phase of the expansion of the universe, after the hot Big Bang, then the mass will be larger. And the question is, how much larger? So the estimate is immediate. The estimate is, let's say that the density is just mass over volume cubed. Mass over length cubed, where the length is the Schwarzschild radius. Schwarzschild radius, you can express it in terms of mass. So now I can solve for the mass. negative expression, which makes a lot of sense. It tells you that the smaller the density, the larger the mass, because after all, at low density to reach the Schwarzschild radius, so you have to go way farther away, so you would have a larger Schwarzschild radius. And if you put it into Friedmann equation, where Abel rate squared goes as energy density, you will get at lower Abel rate, you get a larger mass. So now I can put in this formula, the typical scale of the QCD transition. As I was saying before, it's about pion scale. So let's say about a pion per pion wavelength cubed. So an energy density of this kind, you have put 150 MeV. You plug it into this formula, you get 25 solar masses. Now this is really a back of the envelope calculation. To do better, one really needs to take into account that you see the equation of state and the expansion of the universe. And this has been done in various papers recently. And here you can see that the pressure goes down at a scale essentially between 1 and 100 solar masses. And within that range, one has a higher probability of forming black holes. Okay?
Eugenio, may I yes. ask a question?
Yeah. Go ahead.
So how is the threshold density contrast? It's related to the QCD equation of state.
Yes. Oh, how? So you see, so you need a perturbation of order one, density perturbation of order one, and the specific factor depends linearly on the W on the term that appears in the equation of state. Yeah, the details might be more complicated, but that's a good estimate, just linearly.
What I was wondering is this much suppression in pressure is enough to produce primordial black holes or not?
Yeah, good. So the softening of the equation of state allows for a smaller perturbation to produce a black hole, but still it has to be order one. Then once you have it, if you do have a perturbation that large, then the enhancement in production is exponential, but you still have to reach the threshold.
Yeah. Okay.
So the same would be that it's if these perturbations are present, then before this phase, it's highly unlikely to produce black holes. After this phase, it's highly unlikely, and then you have this narrow window where you're producing lots of black holes within this range.
Yeah.
Okay.
And now,
yes.
Here, the abundance of black hole is not tunable. It's fixed because you know the how low your speed of sound becomes here. How exactly. much black hole you will produce is fixed. There is no room here, right?
Yeah, I think it's correct. Yeah, there's the part that is free and not under control is the perturbation, the origin of the perturbation, how large is the perturbation.
Yeah.
But if you make a model for the perturbation, for instance, if you were to assume that it's scale invariant over these three, four refoldings, then the prediction for the mass spectrum is completely fixed.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So as you can see, this range, 0.1 to 100 solar masses, that here I estimated really in two lines just to show where the number comes from, but you should really take this as the range. is a range that if you were to see a black hole below a solar mass, well, you would say immediately, well, this is primordial. It's below a solar mass, a stellar collapse cannot form it. But anyway, if you take the full range, this is within what LIGO-Virgo can see, what LIGO-Virgo is sensitive to. So there's a question of, has LIGO-Virgo already seen gravitational waves from coalescence of black holes that are primordial? Is there a fraction of them that is of that kind? And within candidates of that kind, can we look at the spin and tell if the spin is essentially zero? Because that's the prediction of the microcanonical ensemble. As opposed to all the models of black hole formation where there's really no reason why the spin should be zero. In fact, you would expect that the spin is large. Okay? Yeah, and on top of that, there's the remark that is one can look at the probability distribution for mass, and even if this is the range, the peak would still be between 1 and 30 solar masses, which is also where many of the events observed really fall. So, as I said in the beginning, theoretical black holes provide impressive theoretical laboratories for quantum gravity, but there's a question at this point of if we can start looking for observational evidence of quantum properties of black holes. And it seems to me, it seems to us, my collaborators with Hal, Anuradha, and Satya, that there's an opportunity here, yeah, because one can actually look at population of black holes that coalesce and we receive gravitational waves from them, and we can measure properties of these black holes, in particular the mass and the spin, and look at if there's black holes with essentially zero spin and mass in this range. So let me comment briefly on how this can be done and what we know up to now. So schematically, in a merger, you have two black holes, one with a mass and one in spin A1, and a second one. Don't forget that these are forming a binary, so there's some orbital angular momentum. And when they merge, what you get is a final black hole with final mass M final and final spin A final, and lots of gravitational waves coming out. And while the gravitational waves have a pattern that is complicated and rich, the final object is rather simple, just mass and spin. As were the two initial objects, just mass and spin. So we observe only the gravitational waves. And the question is, how much can we extract from the gravitational waves that we see about the mass and the spin of the progenitors? Okay, so there is an observation that helps us understanding the plots that I'm going to discuss later. This observation really comes, this is really a consequence of general relativity, and the observation has first been made within the numerical relativity community. That is, consider the simple case where you have two black holes, and these two black holes have zero spin and same mass. After all, if you want to test how good your numerical simulations are, you start with simple cases. And so suppose that you have same mass, zero spin, with some initial angular momentum. Then you merge, you find a final mass that is smaller than the sum of the masses because some gravitational waves carry away energy. And don't forget the second law of thermodynamics holds, the entropy increases. So that means that this mass square plus this mass square has to be smaller than this mass square. Okay, so you form this final black hole. The question is, what is the spin of the final black hole? If the first two were zero spin, and the angular momentum was some angular momentum that would allow them to orbit for sufficient number of orbits. Well, it turns out numerically that this angular momentum is in the range 0, 1, as it should be, and it's on the side of being large, and in fact, rather universal and robust, 0.69, in the sense that it's independent from how big was the orbital angular momentum. And if you want an argument for why it should be a larger independent from that, it's that as the system evolves, some of the angular momentum is carried away in the initial phase. Most of it is carried away by gravitational waves. And the final black hole ends up with an amount of angular momentum that is as much as it can carry. Now, why specifically 0.69? Well, I don't know about derivation from general relativity of this number, but it's a numerical observation and it appears to be robust. In fact, one by looking at numerical simulations, one can even find a simple numerical fit for different masses. Suppose that the masses were different, but not too different, then you will get that it's 0.69, in fact, a bit lower than that, if the masses are not exactly equal. So this is what is known, assuming that the two spins are zero. And now what is easy to measure, or at least easier to measure with gravitational waves, is the spin of the final black hole. It's not as easy to measure the initial components, but this provides a way of checking what are the spins of the initial ones, because we know that if they are zero, then one gets a simple final result for the spin. If these initial two are not zero, they have some angular momentum, then the final spin is highly dependent on the initial ones and way more complicated than the final spin. So this is best illustrated in this figure. That is the one that you find in most gravitational wave papers. So again, schematically, you have two black holes, one and two with some orbital angular momentum, and this is the final mass and spin. Clearly, the final mass and spin is between zero and one. I'm plotting it here. So this is final spin. And then a standard way of making these plots is to consider this quantity. It is not the spin of one or the spin of the other black hole, but it's an effective initial spin that is the mass-weighted average of the spins projected in the direction orthogonal to the plane of the angular momentum. Okay? So they are orbiting. This is the plane of the angular momentum. You take the spin of one, you take the spin of the other, you average with masses, and you project in this direction. In particular, if this has zero spin and this has zero spin, zero plus zero times something is zero. So you will get zero Kelly effective and final spin, if the masses were equal, 0.69. And if the masses were not exactly equal, well, a bit below. No, this was the formula I was showing. The masses are not equal, so let me write it here. Equal masses. And here it's Q M1 over M2 different from 1. Yeah, so for instance, here it would be would be 2. I'm calling M1 the large one. Okay. So Now, before I was saying, if the black hole, if a black hole has fixed mass and spin distributed according to the canonical ensemble, then if the black hole has about a solar mass, 30 solar masses, then the spin would be extremely small. It goes as M Planck over M, so 10 to the minus 38, or for practical purposes, zero. So the prediction is Kelly effect is zero, and K final that can be computed using numerical relativity or from the fit that is drawn here, 0.69. So if you have two black holes, microcanonical, I'm saying first generation, in the sense that they are produced in the early universe, for instance, during the QCD phase transition, formed both of them at the same time, both of them 25 solar masses, then they have the same mass, and the prediction that we have is that you should see this point. And if they happen to have slightly different masses, well, maybe something like here. But nothing here, okay? This is if they are both primordial microcanonical, both from the QCD phase transition. Now, suppose that one is from the QCD phase transition, the other is not. For instance, because two have merged, and so they have formed a second generation black hole. So second generation, in the sense that two have merged and form something with larger mass and spin that by itself is gonna be 0.69. So now this one meets another primordial black hole of a first generation, and one can ask what you get. Well, if they are both first generation, you get something here. And once you go, and allow also these mergers of one first and second generation, you get a distribution of this kind, where you have that the lighter ones are with higher mass ratio, and the upper ones are a smaller mass ratio. Okay, so this is the prediction that you find in this paper. That is of the kind, if the cores are formed in the early universe in the QCD phase transition and are in microcanonical equilibrium, you see a population of them, then that population statistically should be distributed according to this ensemble. And I am not separating details. For instance, I could also take into account masses, but I'm color coding it. So equal mass would be here, different masses would go down here, and one primordial, one non-primordial, you would go around this line, but nothing up here, nothing up here. And let me also comment on the fact that if you consider stellar collapse, that is what you would expect to be the standard non-alternative behavior, you would say that for stellar collapse, what you have is that you have a star, this star has some angular momentum, and then the star collapses, something is ejected, but what is not ejected is trapped in a small region. And in this small region, it happens to have a large angular momentum, as large as it can get. And so you would have that, A1 is large. Now, suppose that, now this is for one black hole, but we don't see one black hole, or at least this kind of black holes have been seen with X-rays, and we know that they are there, have a few solar masses and large angular momentum, close to one, above 0.9. Now, with gravitational waves, you see only the merger of two. So suppose that you have two now. They both have this large angular momentum, but they can have large angular momentum, and this large angular momentum can be, for instance, aligned and aligned with the plane of the orbit. This is what could happen, for instance, if they are formed in the same environment where everything is rotating in the same direction, and this one forms a star, and this one forms a star, and they're both rotating in the same direction, and they rotate around each other, and then they meet gravitational waves, and they form a final black hole. And so you will get something that this and this, they're both large, both aligned and aligned with this one. So you will get something like, I can draw it here, something like, something like this, something like this, orbiting this direction. And so you will get here a point up here, stellar collapse. And what you would expect is that what one could have expected is that observations like the LIGO-Virgo observations would see things mostly in this corner, because it would be black holes formed by stellar collapse in a common environment, so large spin aligned with the angular momentum and necessarily large final spin. So in principle, it's easy to distinguish these objects that we are predicting, because they would essentially lie here in the simplest case, so down here for different masses. Or if they meet something of a different nature, then you have to start considering the case where they have an orbital angular momentum, one or the other can have a spin, and that spin can have different orientations, so you get a distribution. Okay, so this is the prediction, and by now there are some data that are available in public, so one can put them on this plot and see if the available events fall into this class. It is somewhere up here or somewhere else. And there's something that people have been commenting on already, that is, besides the somewhat surprise that the black holes observed, they are not in the range of two solar masses, but they are of higher mass around. There are many around 25, 30 solar masses. The second surprise is that they appear to be low spin. And I can put the ones of the first observation run in this plot. You can see the first one in the first view. And they are not in here. They don't have large spin. In fact, they fall the final object that is easier to measure the spin is consistent with being close to 0.69. And the initial constituents, those are more difficult to constrain, but the effective spin can be constrained, and it's compatible with zero for these four events, at least. For this, except this one. This is this one. Now, it's clear that these are statistical statements, and they are not statements about every single event, and one is really looking at the existence of a population or a subset of events that one can identify independently, and once one identifies them, one can ask which of them are primordial. And as I showed in the beginning, events are coming continuously every week, and the catalog is growing quickly. So soon, instead of speaking about properties of every single event, we will be speaking about population statistics of black holes and black hole mergers. And so once we reach that stage, then we can actually start asking concretely and testing this new paradigm, where quantum gravity effects and statistical properties of black holes can be tested by looking at statistical properties of populations, so like the spin of this population. So let me add briefly a few more data, because there's some more recent catalog that is the transient catalog on November 18, where there are about 10 events that you can see here. So this is November 18. By now, there are way many more events. We expect the catalog to be public sometime in second quarter of 2021, I think. By then, I will not be speaking about 10 events, but more, probably hundreds, soon hundreds. It's also good to compare these two more standard scenarios that have been widely considered in the literature. So I have a slide of comparison. So in these four panels, you find the one that I just described, the one that we proposed, compared to the somewhat standard scenario. The points are the same as before. They are the ones of the catalog of 2018, November 2018. So this is essentially the most standard scenario, that is the one that I was describing, the common envelope one. That means you have a star that collapses to a black hole, another star that collapses to a black hole. They form in the same environment. So this star formed with an angular momentum, and this one formed with an angular momentum coming from the same environment, and they are also rotating around each other. Angular momentum is aligned to the individual ones, so to the spin. And so once you consider that, you get a distribution that is not necessarily here, because you still have to do the statistics of the possible directions, but something of this kind. And this is what I was mentioning before, that is people have been arguing that there's a tension with this model data, even if it's just 10 points here, that they show a tension with this model. A different model, that has a different scenario that has been considered, is the isotropic one, that you would find, for instance, in a globular cluster, where things form independently, so each one has its own spin, pointing in a direction that is distributed isotropically. As I was showing in the very beginning, this would be this distribution that is picked on a somewhat large spin, isotropic. So in this case, you would have that these are isotropic. So in particular, it can happen that they are counter-aligned, which would give a zero. But that's not the most likely configuration. That's not the only configuration. In fact, every configuration isotropic is allowed, so you get a distribution of this kind. Now, the question is, how good is this distribution compared to this data? It's fair to say that one has to wait and put in more data. But something one can already do independently of having data is to ask, suppose that you have enough data distributed according to one or the other distribution, would you be able to tell them apart of your statistical test? And even before a statistical test, there are some easy things that one can do, that is, you see this one is bounded, there's nothing up here, there's a boundary, and it's everything below this boundary. Well, here it's on both sides, but one can be more sophisticated and actually do a test, which we have done. I have it somewhere, I think. Here's our test. We did a Kolmogorov's mirror and an Anderson-Darling test to check if they can be distinguished. And well, it depends, depending on the amount of data, we claim that yes, they can be distinguished. In particular, there's a fissure that comes from the microcanonical distribution that others don't have. You all have this spread While the macro-canonical one, as I was commenting already before on the plot, has this sharp peak with nothing on this side and everything on this side. So let me go back. In principle, they can be distinguished. The question is how long we have to wait to have enough data. Before closing, I think it's worth commenting on one more piece of data that is recent and available. So this is 1908-14. This was available online June 20 this year, a few weeks ago. He was in the news clearly because there's something intriguing with the fact that this is a coalescence of with the highest mass rate observed, 23.6 solar masses, so very different masses. And this object of 2.6 solar masses is intriguing because it's not clear if it's a black hole or a neutron star. It's a neutron star. It's intriguing because there would be people would expect that you cannot have neutron stars so big, larger than 2.1 solar masses. 2.6 is either some unexpected equational state or something really weird. So maybe it's not a neutron star, maybe it's a black hole. But if it was a black hole, this would be also a surprise because there's this expectation of a gap between 2 and 5 solar masses with black holes above 5 solar masses, and 2.6 solar masses would be the smallest black hole ever observed. That's what most of the news are focused on, how intriguing this object is and how it formed and what's the mechanism. But I would like to draw attention to the other more boring one, the 23 solar masses one. This system is special in the sense that being a big black hole and a small black hole allows for a high precision measurement, high precision compared to previous measurement, a much better precision in the measurement of spin. So you can see it here. So the final spin, 0.28. And then there's the question of the initial spin. So the other relevant thing is the mass ratio and the initial spin. So to read the initial spin, I really need to go into the paper. So this is the final spin, 0.28. And then KF, projected initial spin that I was discussing before, compatible with zero. There's more. There's an upper bound on the spin of one of the two, 0.06. So if I go back to this plot and I try to put that event, so I'm speaking about GW, the 1908-14. So what I need is chi effective zero and chi final 0.28. So 0.28. And the comment is that this is compatible, this object is compatible with what I discussed before, the macro-canonical ensemble, in the sense that it's in the range, 25 solar masses. And use this formula, or if you want the extension to higher orders, what you have to do is to go down by how much? Well, you would have to get down here to get that final spin because of the I myself. It's in good part a question of waiting to see when we are going to have enough data to be able to falsify this hypothesis of there being primordial black holes microcanonical distributed. So let me the final comment that is in this talk and in this paper, what we have proposed is the first in principle consequence of black hole entropy, something one can test with observations, provides a mechanism for small spin of primordial black holes, results in a signature for typical events on this side. And while it doesn't provide a test already now of Bekensen-Hawking entropy, and probably we should not think of it as a test, but really as a mechanism and a way of making predictions starting from the statistical mechanics of gravity. While we cannot do it yet because of few data, the imminent transition from single gravitational wave events to population analysis might lead us to observation of population of this kind predicted here and a first test of black hole entropy. Okay, I'll stop here. Thank you very much for the attention.
Yeah. So you have finished?
Yes.
Yes. So if you have any question, guys, please ask him, or otherwise, please you can ask. So before that, I have to give a clap for him for giving such a nice talk.
Thank you.
And it's very clear the observational perspectives as well as the theoretical one. And he tried to make a connection between both of them and to motivate us how the analysis can be done. So thank you, Eugenio, for your talk. And you guys, please can ask question to him.
Hi, Eugenio.
Hi.
I have one more question. So if we consistently get a chi effective to be zero, and if it doesn't violate the upper bound which you show, the upper boundary curve, right? This would mean that there is some kind of a microcanonical equilibrium which is guaranteed. But will it guarantee primordial black holes?
Yeah, they are independent. So let me comment on this. So first, chi effective zero or observations of black holes with zero spin. Now, one can ask for mechanisms, and here I'm providing one, and it's a really simple and immediate one. It's you wouldn't even characterize it as mechanism. It's just the most likely thing once you look at probabilities in phase space. So if you see something of zero, a black hole of zero spin, this provides an immediate explanation, a mechanism, and one has to ask if this is the correct explanation. There might be other explanations, other mechanisms. Arguing that this is the mechanism requires that one considers other independent evidence for that being the explanation for zero spin. For instance, if a stellar black hole happens, or a black hole formed from stellar collapse happens to be observed and have zero spin, then you would argue that this was not the mechanism. Something else happened after the black hole formed. The black hole formed with a large spin, and then after there was a process that was lowering the spin of the black hole dynamically. What would reinforce the argument that it's zero spin because of microcanonical? Well, I argue that microcanonical requires the appropriate environment. And one environment that I describe in detail is primordial black holes formed in the early universe, for instance, in the QCD phase transition. So if you start correlating masses in that range with spin, so 25 solar masses, zero spin, then you have a more robust argument. Clearly, there are things that make it absolutely clear that the black hole has to be primordial, because there are other mechanisms that could produce 25 solar masses. For instance, two smaller mass black holes that merge, even though that would result in a large spin, then you would have another mechanism that lowers the spin. So primordial can produce automatically 25 solar masses with small spin. If one was to observe a black hole below one solar mass, one would essentially know that that had to be primordial, and then one could measure the spin. And if the spin was also zero, then it would be, then I would say it would be a strong argument for saying that's a microcanonical primordial.
Thank you. Yeah.
Well, and again, many of these arguments, I think, have to be taken as there's a scenario that applies to population statistics, not to every single event. There might be a subpopulation of this kind, and there's no claim that every black hole should be of this kind. In fact, as data keep coming, there might be more and more surprises coming, and I guess we're going to know soon. It's a fast-moving field.
So, Eugenio, there is a question in the chat box. Can you able to see the chat box?
Yes, let me read it. Oh, okay. So the question from Nihala is, so I argued that a stellar collapse results in large spins, both in the sense of the spin of one black hole and the final spin of the after the merger, so large spins close to one. And the question is, can one explain this from the microstate picture? So I would argue that in a microstate picture, this would be one specific microstate, or not one microstate, but an ensemble of microstates, all with large spin. So you are not probing a random state or a typical state in the full space of states, but only within this specific value of the spin. So going back to the polymer chain analogy, if you have a narrow tube and you have a polymer chain in that narrow tube, if the tube is large compared to the typical radius, you reach the typical radius of the polymer chain. But if the tube is narrower, then you cannot explore every configuration, and you get a longer chain. And here one can argue that black holes formed in this process of stellar collapse, they cannot explore all angular momentum. They are locked into this channel. But still, there are all the other black hole microstates that are uniformly explored. And being uniformly explored gives the Bekesen-Hawking entropy with mass and spin. That everybody, I guess, still expects all the other microstates are uniformly explored. If they were not, then a black hole wouldn't have that entropy. I hope it answers your question.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
The other participants, if you want to ask, please ask. There is another one. Oh, okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, so other participants, do you have any question? I don't think so. So let me stop recording. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Sam.
Yeah, so just I need to talk to you. I just stopped recording and asked the other participants to leave.
Yes, we are, I would like to discuss with you a bit.